Wilson, and we're being trained for this webinar. My name is LaDonna, and I'm the moderator. Before we get started, I want to explain the session format. This webinar is being recorded for future distribution. The phone lines are muted, and all conversations will be via the question chat feature. We will only be able to answer questions that pertain to Camille's presentation or reports. If you have a question that relates to today's topic and information that Camille is covering, please submit it via the question box. We will do our best to reply to each sender as questions are submitted. We will select a few common questions to share with Camille so everyone benefits from her answer. Unfortunately, due to the large number of registrants, we will be unable to answer questions that are unrelated. If you do not see the question box, click on question from the control panel that appears on the side of your screen. If you want to move the control panel out of the way, click the red arrow to the right. Click the red arrow again to see your control panel. You can also maximize the presenter screen. Please notice that there are a few handouts that you might want to download to support your learning. If you would like to open your own Destiny Library Manager site to follow along with what's being shown on the screen, please feel free to do so. Thank you for joining us. We will now begin, and I will turn the webinar over to Camille.
Thanks so much, LaDonna. As she said, my name is Camille Sullivan, and I will be the trainer working with you this afternoon as we look at reports. And let everyone know a little bit about my background. I was a high school social studies teacher turned school librarian, and the one constant in my entire library career has always been Wildland, and it's always been Destiny. So I'm happy to be able to share some information about reports from each of you today. And with that, let's go ahead and get started. So the first thing I want us to look at is going to be our agenda. It is definitely a packed agenda, to say the least. We're going to talk about accessing some report data in maybe an uncommon location. I think a lot of times people just think of the reports tab as the only place to get library data. But I'll be able to show you a great location to be able to get some data that isn't directly bound just under the reports tab. Some of the common questions that we get a lot when it comes to reports has to do with barcode lists. And so when we particularly focus on that topic, what we'll look at is your ability to be able to actually create and print unused barcodes so that you can just peel and stick them on your book when it comes time to process. And so we'll show how you're able to do that. Then we'll talk about two things that you can do with your title and copy list. One is a report that I like to call your shelf setter report. Because a lot of us, we always struggle with really knowing what's circulating, what's not circulating, what should I read, what should I not read, those types of things. There will be several reports that we'll look at today that will give us the opportunity to sort of laser focus our efforts when it comes to reading our collections. And one of those will be that shelf setter report. Also, while we're there, I'm going to quickly be able to show you how you have the ability to see your lost copies and their circulation data that went along with it. Because if you have some cash and you're ready to replace some lost books, of course, you don't want to be replacing books that really only had one circulation when it got lost. And you definitely want to make sure you're replacing that particular copy that maybe had, a dozen circulations. Got lost. And so it's going to give you some of that data to help you make some better purchasing decisions. We'll talk about hold statistics. Whether you do interlibrary loan or if you just do hold on your particular campus, the popular question that we get abroad is, well, how do I know which one of my books my kids are placing on hold repeatedly so that I can purchase new copies? And so we'll show how that particular report works. Then we're going to go over and take a look at collection statistics summary. And hands down, one of my favorite Destiny reports, simply because it can be your best friend when it comes to advocating for your library, funding, implementing new changes, things like that. And so we'll take a good look at that. Then we will talk about current checkouts and fines, and just some tips and tricks and maybe a few things that can help make that whole process a little bit easier, faster, and ultimately a bit more efficient in the long run. And another common request we're getting a lot these days is I want to set up a student self-checkout station, and somebody I saw had command barcodes, and I don't know how to get those, so I'll show you how you can get those command barcodes, which really help make the efficiency of your student self-checkout station a breeze. And then last but not least, we will touch on Report Builder, and we'll take a look at that, and just some tips and tricks that I think can make the whole process of Report Builder just a little bit easier for folks. So now what I want to do is I'm going to actually pull over another screen, and this is my Destiny site that I operate out of, and my particular campus is Jenny Thompson High School. Most everything that I'm going to do today is focused at the school level, because at the school level is where the majority of our webinar participants actually spend the majority of their time, is at a school or a site level. And so we will touch on a couple of little things that if you are a district level administrator or a district library manager, a couple of things that can help you do things a bit more efficiently as well at the district level. But for the most part, everything that I'm going to do today is going to be solely focused on the site level. And so what I'm going to do is, this is my particular district site, and I'm going to select my campus. For my students, when they click on my campus, they are immediately redirected to Destiny Discover. That's the choice that I've made for my students. And it's not difficult for me to be able to pop back over into traditional Destiny. And I do that by going over and clicking on the three lines and menu slides up. And if you just click on that top option, Destiny, it pops me right back over into the Destiny that we all know and use every single day. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to log into my account. And so here's my school site. And the first thing that I wanted to share with you guys is report type data that isn't necessarily under the Reports tab. And that can be found by just going to the Circulation tab and going down to the very last option, and it says Library Information. It lands on a subtab that gives you what all of your different due dates are, but you'll notice that there are four additional subtabs that are here. The first one looks at your statistics, and it's just a library snapshot. And of course, every piece of data we can pull from this library information option can also be found in reports. But oftentimes what I find is people, when they go to the reports tab, there's this unnecessary or undue anxiety that sometimes follows along with it. And I've always asked folks, well, why is it that you have this anxiety when you go to reports? And one of the things that I commonly hear is, well, I'm so afraid I'm going to mess something up. Well, if there is a tab in Destiny that you can't really, you can't do anything to manipulate your data, it's the reports tab, because all you're doing is you are pulling the data that's already in the system and presenting it to you in a report format. So if you're hesitant and afraid that you're going to mess something up with your data, you don't need to worry about that, because that's not going to happen from within the reports tab. So when I'm at circulation and library information, I have this library snapshot that sort of tells me the number of items I have, how many are overdue, holds that I have, all that kind of stuff. But if you look down at the bottom, you have the ability to really customize a number of these areas so that you can really get the specific information that you're looking for. If you've ever needed to know what all of your checkouts and check-ins for the day were, you can click right down at the bottom of that library snapshot page, and you can see all of your checkouts that you've had for the day. You can click to see view current statistics. Sometimes when you click on this, some of you may get in your URL address bar a little message about pop-up blockers. Just turn it off and it'll immediately present itself to you. But you can see
your current library statistics, how many holds, renewals, that type of stuff, circulations, for today, this year, this month, that type of thing. And so being able to pinpoint and narrow down exactly the data that you're wanting, whether it's a date range or a specific time frame of, you know, the last 2 months, something like that, you're certainly able to do that and customize what data you're getting up here at the top. If I go over to the next sub-tab, you can see your top patrons. It will list them in the order of, you know, the highest number of circulations to the lowest number of circulations. You can see up to 50 patrons, and again, you can customize the time frame in which you want to see that data presented up at the top. You could also just select a specific grade level if that's what you wanted. If you were doing, you know, a special promotion with a certain grade level, you could simply select that particular grade level, update the report, and that data would immediately change and represent whatever grade level you've selected and who those top patrons would be. If I go over to top homeowners and grade levels, again, similar type data, but instead of individual students, it's going to be specific teachers. Each teacher's name would be listed in the order of the highest circulations to the lowest circulations, how many patrons they have in each class, what the average circulation per patron is, what's that number, and then just the total number of circulations as well. And again, you can customize down at the bottom. You can include your faculty, exclude your faculty, you know, do it for specific number of days, weeks, months, whatever it may be. So you can customize and really get it to be the exact data that you're looking for. And then the very last sub-tab are your top and bottom titles. And, you know, again, you have the ability to go up and see all the way up to your top 50 titles, and you can choose whatever date range you want, whether it's by, you know, number of years, months, or days. You can choose to include or exclude library in-use circulations. You can select a specific material type, or you can do all your materials. You can do a call number range, so forth and so on. So you really have a lot of ability to customize the type of data you want to see in regards to that top and bottom title report that's listed there. And each of these are very easy to print off. And so it's a quick, easy way for you to be able to get report type data, but not necessarily have to actually go over into reports to access that. So LaDonna, any questions about our accessing report data in a rather unusual location before we pop over to the actual reports tab?
Not at this time, Camille, but that is one of my favorite little shortcuts, so I'm glad you shared it with everybody.
Absolutely. So definitely, I think it's a big time saver for a lot of people, and they don't really know that it exists, so I always like to make sure that I point that out to folks when we're talking about reports. So now what I'm going to do is pop over to the Reports tab. And, of course, when you click on Reports, it's always going to land on the option that says My Favorites. Some of you may have reports that are your favorites that you run fairly often, and you may have those listed. I don't have any reports that I run so frequently that I call them a favorite. I just have all of, you know, any specific report that I may have saved. I just have in one general location instead of having some listed as favorites, but some people may actually have some favorites listed there. Of course, when you look, we have several different options that are over off to the side. We have library reports, patron reports, and report builder that's listed there. These are the three that we're going to focus on today because, of course, our topic today has to deal with library manager. But another question that I often get from folks when it comes to dealing with the reports tab is, Camille, I just don't know which one to select. And so I always share with customers that I work with, anytime you go to reports, you should ask yourself one of two questions. Am I wanting a report about the things in my library, or am I wanting a report about the people using my library? If you ask yourself one of those two questions each time you come to the reports tab, you will never flounder in regards to which of the two library reports or patron reports you select, because it will will immediately direct you to the correct tab. So if I'm wanting a report about the things in my library, of course, I'm going to choose library reports. And so the first report that we wanted to take a look at is barcode lists. But real fast, let me go back. Let me show you something. You'll notice that at the end of each line, there is a little button that says show more. If I open that up, it will give me a bit more of a detailed example of what kind of data I can pull from that particular report. So if you aren't sure that this is the report that you need, you can always click where it says show more, and it will give you a bit more detail. So I'm going to go ahead and choose barcode list because that's the first one that I wanted to take a look at. And what you'll notice is it will say, you know, list copy barcodes, and I have an option here to choose either used barcode numbers or unused barcode numbers. Well, when I select unused barcode numbers, I can actually select how many barcodes I want to have created. And so I have the ability to be able to come in here and I can say, excuse me, that I want to create, let's say, 999 barcodes. And I want to start with, my barcodes all start with 9500 3. And then they're all 14 digits. So that's 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. And I can come down here and I can say that I want consecutive barcodes as a range, or I want all of the barcodes. And so when I do this, it's going to be able to create a report for me that's going to let me see which barcodes are actually available as far as me, if I want to start filling in any gaps or holes that potentially, you know, because as we catalog or as we read, we're going to have potential huge gaps in our barcode ranges. And a lot of people like to try to go back and fill in some of those gaps and holes. And so when you create this report and you run the report, let's see, Bravada does not begin with the, I must have typed the first part in wrong. Let me see. Anytime you ever need to know what your barcode characteristics look like, you can always click where it says generic code. And so I just got the first part wrong. So let's go back using our breadcrumbs always. And so I can come back up here and I can say that I want to see 999. And then if I put in the right numbers, so then 1, 2, 3, 4. That's 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. So let's try this again. Here we go. It always helps when you have the right numbers in the front. And so, of course, the report will run. And what I did is I actually already have the report run so that we can pull that up. Let me load that and pull it over for you so you can see what it looks like. Yeah. And so it produces for me a report that tells me all of the barcodes from this number to this number that I have gaps or holes. So some people, as they're cataloging, like to have a list like this and begin to mark those off if they need them. And anytime you see a range, I would be able to use 295 as well as 296. Here I could do 385, 386, 387, and 388. So for some people, that's a common request that I get quite often, is they want to be able to see what those holes or misses are. And so I always like to be able to point that out to them when we take a look at the list, the copy barcodes that are listed there. LaDonna, were there any questions in regards to that particular report?
We had a couple of questions, but they were answered by the moderators.
Fantastic. All right, great. So let's talk about our title and copy list next. So still again in library reports because we're looking for more about the things in our library. Now we go down to copy and title list. What we here have the ability to do is I could come in and I can say that I want to know all the books that are shelf sitters that maybe I added and have been in my library for, let's say, maybe the last 10 years. So I could come in here and I could say copies added, and I could put the date, anything that was before. And typically what I do, whatever date I'm working on today, I would select that. But then I would just go in and I would change it to 10 years in the past. And that way I have the ability to only see books that were added before today's date, but 10 years ago. And then what I would do is I would say that I want to see with all copies. And if you have genrefied your library, you may want to include the categories. Because, of course, when you're genrefied library, we all typically say a best practice is to put your genre sublocations in both your copy categories as well as in sublocations. And that way you have the ability to pull data. And this would be an example of that data that you can pull. If you haven't genrefied your library, you can certainly omit including categories. And then, of course, you can choose circulation statistics. When I include circulation statistics, now what happens is I have the ability to say that I only want to show copies that have circulated equal to zero times total. And then, of course, as most reports in Destiny, I have the ability to say if I want it in a PDF or if I want it in Excel. Typically, I like my reports to be in Excel because what I like to be able to do is I like to be able to pull that report up. And if there are certain things that I want to be able to hide or I don't want to see or deal with, I can certainly go in and just hide columns and things like that. So for me, I typically choose Excel. And then, of course, I can either save the report or I can run the report. And I often say that you want to work smarter, not harder. So oftentimes, if it's a report that you think you're going to run quite often, definitely take the extra seconds to click save the report. And you can certainly just come in here and you can call this. As soon as Camille unlearns to spell my shelf sitter report. And then I would say probably in parentheses, I would put 10 years. And then I would save and run that particular report. There we go. And of course, just for the sake of time, what I've done is I've already run the report in the past. And now if I wanted, what I could do is I can say that these are all books that were added prior to that date from 10 years ago that have had zero circulations, and I could then take this report, it populates it automatically in call number order, and I could go out in a very systematic and methodical manner and be able to pull these books that are what I call shelf sitters. And maybe some of these books are really great, but I need to do some programming or change the way that they're highlighted or I draw attention to them in my library. And so it doesn't necessarily mean that I would read each of these books, but I would definitely take a look at each of them, see if there's entire sections that maybe I need to, create a program or do something with to sort of encourage my kids to read these books. Because let's face it, we all know we have great books sitting on our shelves that sometimes don't ever actually get used. And it's just because our kids don't know that they're there. But if you're looking for a report that easily allows you to identify their shelf sitters, that's a great, great report to take a look at. So, LaDonna, any questions about that title or copy list in regards to the shelf sitters?
I think we're handling the questions as they come through. Thanks, Camille.
Fantastic. And then the last thing I'll show you in regards to title and copy list, another common question that we get quite a bit always has to do with which books are lost because they like to replace the lost books. And so typically what I say to you is just say you want to select them by title, but you want to show titles with lost copies. And again, I can choose to include my circulation statistics. And so typically what I say is I want to say anything that had more than three total circulations. Again, if I had a genre card in my library, I may want that category to appear. And then you can, of course, choose to do PDF or Excel as well. And then that report will generate and run for you. And then you have that opportunity to make some selective purchases in regards to the replacing of lost books. Okay. So let's go back to library reports, and let's take a quick look where we talk about hold statistics. So one of the things that a lot of librarians sometimes struggle with is the concept of holds. And so when you're in library reports, of course, you have the ability to go to the particular section that's labeled holds, and I can see all of the current holds or reservations that I may have, and I can certainly put in a date range, either after, on, or before a specific date. I can include only ILLs or exclude certain ones, so forth and so on. That's just going to give me a list of my current things that are happening in regards to holds. If I need to email or print off hold notifications, I can go in here. I can sort them by homeroom if that's what I need to do. Let them, you know, I can, of course, customize this message here. If you have email set up in your district, you certainly have the ability to send these out via email, and you can send them to the students, and you can run those notifications. But what I'm specifically talking about today are actual hold statistics. So if I scroll down a little bit further under library reports, I'm going to find the section that talks about hold statistics. And so by clicking show more, it's going to show me select the title with the call number and specify a benchmark for the number of holds. When I open up this particular report, what it's going to give me the opportunity to do is I can come in here, and again, I can do it by either title or call number. Typically, I always did mine by title. I left my ranges here open. They were just open-ended. And I would say anything that had more than two holds placed on it. Because let's say that you have, you know, you've had at least two students place a book on hold. We all know that all of our students don't always take the time to place a hold or ask us to place the hold. And so my theory always is, you know, for every two kids, there's four more that didn't have the, you know, the guts or the time or whatever to come up and ask me to do it for them, or they didn't want to take the time to do it themselves. And so for me, I always just use the benchmark of two. And then I can come in here and I can run that report, and it would allow me to see, excuse me, any books that have been placed on hold for more than twice. Now, of course, I am on a campus that isn't a real campus. It is a fictitious pretend place. And so my students that don't really exist weren't really placing anything on hold. But it does give you that ability to answer that question. Madonna, are there any questions?
I think that so far we're answering them, the ones that have pertained to the topics you've addressed as you come to them. We have a few that are out that you haven't gotten to yet. So I think we're good.
Okay, perfect. Sorry, I got all sick. I had to cough. Oh, mercy. So if you're needing more specific information in regards to the holds that are occurring in your library, definitely make sure that you check out the hold statistics section under statistics. And I think you'll get the data that you're looking for, as opposed to when you're just focusing on the section that's labeled for holds. That's often a common mistake or thing that I see a lot of folks do. So I definitely wanted to make sure that I wanted to share that. Next up, what I wanted us to take a look at is looking at our collection statistics summary. So if we go up a couple from hold statistics, and if we click on the one that says collection statistics summary, some of you, when you click on it, you may get a message that says it can't be run during certain hours of the day. That's very common, especially if your school district or division hosts themselves, just because you don't want such a huge report to run in the midst of the main part of your day, because it could slow your server down. So if you get that message, message. I do encourage you to just write yourself a note that, you know, whatever is outside of that time range, run that report so that you can see the data that will appear there, because this report can do a lot for advocacy, because let's face it, most of us are on a school campus or a site where there's only one of us, and we have to make sure we're letting people know what it is that we do each and every day. So, when I click on collection statistics summary, the first thing you'll notice is we have three sub-tabs. The first tab talks about circulation, the second one focuses on age, and the third one talks about value. And each of those play a very important role in our overall collection. But the first one that I want us to take a look at is circulation. And so one of the first things that I like to point out is when you look at the circulation sub-tab and you look at your areas of your collection that have the highest number of circulations. And that's what this middle section is. Between these two green bars, these all talk about circulations. The first section, our first column talks about circulations today, second is this month, this year, and the last one talks about total. And so typically what I like to do is I always like to make sure that my highest area of circulation is also one of my larger collections as far as number of items in the collection. So let me show you what I mean. So when I look at, let's just say, like, I want to say circulations for just this year, because my district has had Destiny for a number of years, and of course, this, you know, the student population that I had 3 years ago isn't the same population that I have today, because our populations change with time. And so I really want to focus my attention on what my kids have been circulating this year. And so when I look at my highest area of circulation this year, we can see that 75.78% of my total circulation just this year come from fiction. And so what I always like to do is I'd like to compare that total number of circulations with what is the total percentage of my overall collection. And so if I go over to the far right-hand side, this particular column shows me what percentage of my total collection is fiction. So 34.68% of my entire collection is fiction. But 75.78% of my circulations fall within that 34.68%. So for me, this immediately tells me that I need to make sure that I am advocating for money, that I then have the opportunity to go and purchase more materials so that I can have a percentage of my collection that mimics more closely the percentage of my circulations. Now, of course, I'm never going to have a fiction section that has 75% of my overall collection. I'm probably not ever going to do that. But when I see that my fiction section is only 34 or 35%, I'm definitely going to want to ask for funding to increase that particular section of my library to meet the reading needs of my students. So for me, this was a great way to really pinpoint for advocacy purposes which section that I really want to focus my attention on, because I know that my main purpose for being at my school is to really meet the needs of my kids. And if I don't beef up that particular section of my collection, I'm doing a disservice to my students, because clearly that is where their main interest is really lying at the time. If I go over to the second sub-tab that talks about age, this particular sub-tab really is going to allow you the opportunity to laser focus your efforts when it comes to reading. So many times, and as a former district administrator, I know how difficult it is for a lot of people to find time to actually read your collection. And what I find is a lot of times people say, you know, well, I have 30 minutes or I have 20 minutes to do something before the next class came in.
So I just start over here, the closest section, and I'm going to work my way around the library. And for me, that is not using your time wisely. I'll say it again. I am a big believer in working smarter, not harder. And so for me, I typically tried to, as a district administrator, I really tried to encourage my staff to focus their attentions on the areas that I call the worst offenders. And so when you're on the sub-tab for age, I can very quickly and easily see, and I'm just going to focus my attentions just on my nonfiction because that's what's up at the top. I can go over to my second column under the category for age, and I can quickly see which one of my nonfiction areas has the worst average age of collection. And so when I look, I can immediately see that my 800s are my worst offenders with an average age of 11 years. If I come over and I click where it says 800 to 899, look what happens. It opens up that Dewey range by tens. And again, I can go to that second column that shows me that average age and look at what a difference the average age here is. So here we can see which each of those particular tens is the worst offender for my 800. So again, if I look at my list, here's one that's for 24 years. But if I scroll down to the bottom, we can see that the 890s to 899, the average age of collection is 28 years. I can also see there are a total of 19 items, and I can see that by either looking at the very last column to the far right, or I can also see that same number by just going over and looking over to the left of that average age. So definitely this is the area that I want to focus my attentions on most. So again, you'll notice that over here on that left-hand side, these numbers are hyperlinked. So if I click on 890 to 899, it's going to open it up. And now look what I have the ability to do. I now have an opportunity to come in here and look at that average age. And we can see that 45 years is the average age for my books in 895, and there are 9 books. We can all go to our shelves and look at 9 books that have a call number of 895, and we can do that in 5 minutes or less. And we all know that when it comes to reading and raising your average age of collection, if you tackle those worst offenders first, you will see the largest amount of growth in your overall age of collection. This is a much more laser-focused approach to reading than starting at one end of your library and working your way through. This is really going to help you attack those worst offending sections. Of course, I can't read all 9 of my books, but I could quickly go and make quick decisions by just looking at those 9 books in my section 895 to determine which ones, are definitely leading candidates. And that is where you guys will see your largest growth in that average age of collection, if that's something that you're trying to work towards and work on. So you have that ability to take a look and see that. Some people often like to know what those particular books are. From this particular age screen, I don't have that ability. But if I go over and I click on circulations, here you can see where my 895s are. If I go to that far right hand, you'll see that 9 is hyperlinked. And if I click on it, it's now going to show me what the title is. It'll show me what the barcode numbers are, so forth and so on. It'll show me how many, it's circulated today, this month, this year, last year, total, so forth and so on. So you have the ability to see it in that regard as well. Typically,
And I was dealing with such a fair number of books, I typically just went to the shelf and pulled them in myself. But you certainly can see the particular titles listed individually. You just have to make sure that you go back over to that circulation sub tab because you can't access it from the age tab. Okay? LaDonna, any questions about that particular option?
Well, we had one question that I think probably a lot of people would be interested in, and it's how does the age subtab and collections that summary data compare with the TitleWise analysis age information? And is it more detailed? And I think it has the same breakdowns and probably has the same statistics if your TitleWise analysis has been uploaded.
Exactly. You know,
okay, good.
Yeah, that's a great question. And, of course, this is going to be what I would say is your most accurate at that moment, simply because it's analyzing your current collection. But if you have just cataloged a number of books and added things to your collection, you've done some weeding, so forth and so on, definitely make sure that your TitleWise analysis is also up to date and current as well, because you certainly have different ways to look at data between the two. TitleWise definitely does things in more of a picture or graph format versus what we have in Destiny, where it's giving you, you know, what I call the facts and nothing but the facts. So it really, if you're wanting accuracy at this exact moment, I definitely say Destiny is going to be your best bet. But if you have an accurate and a current up-to-date TitleWise analysis, the data is going to be very, very similar. It should be accurate, you know, exactly the same, depending on which areas maybe you decide to hide or omit, things like that, because you certainly have that capability to hide and not count certain sections of your collection when you're doing a TitleWise analysis. So you'd have to look at that as well if there's any discrepancies. But Donna, anything you can think to add to that?
No, that was that's great.
Perfect. Okay. So next I want us to pop over to patron reports because one of the common things I hear a lot is when it comes to their current checkouts and fines, especially this day and age with so much being done digitally, people are like, I want to be able to send email overdue notices instead of having to print them out. And you certainly have the ability to do that. So because I'm going to do a report in regards to the people using my library, I'm going to switch over and I'm going to go to patron reports. When I open up current checkouts and fines, you'll see that I have a couple of reports that I have listed here. The first one I want to show you is the one that I have listed here for Mr. Delaney weekly overdue email scheduled for every Tuesday at 10:15. What I did with this particular report, and I'll walk you through each of the different screens, is when I was an elementary librarian, my students all turned their books in before the school day started. I worked like a mad woman trying to get them all checked in before my first class came in. And my teachers did come in on a rotation. They actually stayed in the library with me, which was fantastic. I know not all of us have that same luxury. But what I did was 30 minutes before that teacher came to the library, I set up an automatic email from within Destiny to email these teachers. And it would say, you know, the following students still have overdue materials. And those teachers would take a minute, ask their students to find their books. Maybe it was in their cubby, their backpack, their desk, whatever it was. And oftentimes the kids came to the library with those missing materials. That way we didn't have anybody running back to the classroom unsupervised, things like that. And so it helped a lot. Yes, there was a lot of setup on the front end because I would take my schedule, figure what 30 minutes prior to that time was, and I created unique, specific reports for each of those teachers. So, of course, I said anything that was overdue, unpaid library fines, patron fines. The magic was this particular email to homerooms. When I went to the next screen, of course, I only wanted to include the students that had materials that were missing. You can certainly come in here and say all materials, or which you select specific materials, whichever ones you like. Materials that my patrons have that may belong to someone else, I include that. I typically only included
active students, because sometimes we may have had a student that withdrew but still owned something, and it took, a period of time for a student to be inactive before they were moved to that particular status. So I always just included active. When I went on to the next screen, this is where I would go in and I would select the individual teacher who was there. Once I would select it, of course, I would say, okay. Typically, the display name, I always made it unique to the name of the library. The email, I highly recommend having a do not reply email address created for any district or division. That way, each librarian has the opportunity to be able to share that do not reply email address, and that way you don't get bombarded with any kind of bounce backs that you may get. So that's just a little tip and trick I like to share. And then down towards the bottom, you can include the title, of course. Including the cover image is always helpful. The teacher isn't always going to know what the cover of every book looks like. And let's face it, sometimes our kids forget what the cover of the book looks like as well. And you can include whatever price or bargain, any of this information that you choose to do. And then, of course, I would save that particular. I was very detailed in how I saved them. It was, Mr. Delaney weekly overdue email. I set them to run weekly. I did always say don't run it on days that were closed. And remember, if you close your calendar for, winter break and spring break and things like that, if you have this particular box checked, that email will also not go because the library is closed on those particular days. And then I selected the day of the week that I would see Mr. Delaney's class and whatever 30 minutes prior to his scheduled library time was, and then I would save that report. I did this for every one of my teachers, and just like clockwork, Destiny did that work for me. It was sending those emails automatically, and the return rate of missing materials increased drastically. I even found that sometimes, kids would check out library books. It was such a hit. It made it to the teacher's library shelf, and because this email was going, it was a quick and easy way for them to be able to locate those materials and get them back to the library. So I did this annually for each of my teachers. The next year when the schedule shifted, I would come in here and I would alter and tweak whatever this needed to be as far as the day of the week and the time, so that it was accurate for the next year. If the teacher left, well, then I subbed in the new teacher's name and changed it up here in the top for whatever that teacher's name may be that replaced that individual. So the first year, a little time consuming, but once you set it up once, it's going to automatically run for you, and you don't have to take care of that anymore. Of course, when you're doing overdue fines and fees with any of your students, just know that if you choose to do notices and you choose to change it to a different language, make sure that you realize it's only actually changing the format or the layout of the document itself. So if I were to choose Spanish, instead of it saying name, it would say nombre. Instead of the date, it would say fecha, those types of things. It doesn't actually translate the title of the book, because the title of the book is the title of the book. So know that that doesn't translate any of the students' data itself. It's just the frame of the report. When you are creating your overdue reports for your students, know that you can customize this message in any way that you like. Typically, I always say try to not always make your overdue message something negative, because a lot of times, when people begin to see the same message over and over again, sometimes they stop reading the message altogether, which is certainly not what we want. So if you're going to have a follow-up book fair next week, or you're going to have a literacy night or something like that, or Grandparents' Day, put those notes in as well. And then there's a positive side to what it is that you're trying to share. And so I always like to include that. Something else I'll share again, using that same do not reply email address. Everyone in your district or division can use it. I also highly encourage you, when it comes to your student email user defined fields, that you have them labeled as student parent one, parent two, blah, 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 instead of just saying email 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
especially when it comes to privacy issues and concerns for especially our older secondary students. You definitely want to make sure if you're sending, you know, a hold notice or an overdue notice, and you're going to send it to the student, you definitely want to make sure you're sending it to the student's email address and not the parent email address, of course, for privacy purposes. So there's a lot that you can do within current checkups and fines that you can set things up to run automatically so that you are not physically having to go in and do that. And anytime you have email notifications set up, it really is a great way to have those go out via email and for you not to physically have to go in and do it each time. And again, it would be a matter of when you go to that same setup, setting it up to either run weekly, I would say never run anything daily, because I wouldn't want an email daily, but you can set them up, and I do think that these are big time savers for you. And like I said, you're going to have a lot of work on the front end, but on the back end, I do highly recommend doing it because it makes your day-to-day operation much, much easier and more efficient, I think. Any questions about current checkouts and fines, LaDonna?
Camille, we had several people asking questions about the email, and if you would like your email to be configured, that's something usually your tech people can set up with our tech people. And people asked about getting teachers' emails in there, and depending on, everything is dependent upon the patron record, and sometimes you can upload those. One other thing I just thought I would mention is that... what I think is helpful, if you have a large Spanish-speaking population and you have maybe a Spanish teacher with a keyboard on their computer, a lot of schools will put that overdue message in the body of the note in English and in Spanish, and that way your students are covered that maybe have Spanish.
Oh, that's nice. Please. Oh, that's a good idea. Yeah, that's a good idea. Excellent. So hopefully that helped folks that were, you know, looking for a more efficient way of doing current checkouts and fines, because it can be time consuming, especially if you're doing it on a real regular basis. So hopefully that helps some of you. The other question that we get really, really often has to do with patron. They've set up a student self-checkout station, and they go to somebody else's library, and they see that they have command barcodes taped down, and command barcodes are often check in, check out, and reset. And they're like, how in the world do they get those? Well, it's very easy to do them. You can actually go to where it says labels and cards under patron reports, and there's a report that says patron ID cards. When you click on patron ID cards, you can choose to do a particular teacher or whatever, because you really only need to do one teacher. You don't have to do it for everybody. You can create a teacher's patron ID barcodes, and you can choose to include to choose whoever it is you might want to include. That part doesn't matter. You can include your students, the staff, that kind of stuff, because really the magic is down towards the bottom, because what will happen is as we go through and we are actually hold on, I think I clicked on the barcode labels. No, we want patron ID cards. When I'm here, excuse me, and I've chosen my homeroom teacher, so let's pick that person. And I'm selecting whoever it is that I want, and however your formats, your names want, that same sort of thing. Actually, I'm so sorry. We want barcode labels. Sorry about that, everybody. Look, even I got mixed up. If you want the command barcodes, you've got to go to print barcode label. Sorry about that. And again, I can come in and I can choose, you know, an individual person's name. And I could just do Miss Smith to Miss Smith. That part doesn't matter. And I can put their name, grade level, so forth and so on. But down at the bottom, what I'm trying to point out, and apparently not doing very well because I confused myself, is you'll notice there is an option that says use at the circulation desk. You'll see you have the opportunity when it says start a new page for each group. So if you really did wanted to have each of your homeroom teachers each had an individual sheet and each of their kids were listed on that sheet with their barcodes, you could do that. But down here where it says include library circulation command barcodes, when you choose that particular option, what's going to happen for you is you would then be given the opportunity to, when you run this particular report, and I'll run it for us real quick, it won't take long. When we open it, up at the top, of course, we're going to have the barcodes for the kids or the teachers that are there. But what you want is down at the bottom. And you can just cut these off. I will tell you, at my student self-checkout station, I didn't necessarily ever include the patron status because that just wasn't an option in access levels that I gave my students. But they did have reset, check out, and check in, depending on whatever the task was that they were going to be doing at that time. And so that's how you can get those command barcodes that you can then put at your student self-circulation desk. If you're interested in student self-checkout, I will tell you over in the handouts section of your control panel, you will see that there is a document that says set up a self-checkout station, and you can actually click on it and download that document. That's available to you, and you're certainly welcome to do that if that's something that you're interested in. And the very last thing that I'll touch on is Report Builder. Report Builder is something that I would venture to say that probably the majority of librarians don't really ever have to use, simply because the data that they need for their school or their site is often able to be attained by just using our pre-configured library reports and patron reports. Oftentimes, when someone needs to create a report builder report, it's oftentimes done at the district level because it allows you to compare all of your campuses and things like that. And I'll show you an example of that in a moment. But if the time comes that you do actually have to create a report builder report, the tips and tricks that I share with you is this. Do not select everything. Because I see this a lot. People will come in and they'll just say, oh, gosh, I don't know what it is that I want. I'm just going to say I want to select everything. But what you have to realize is when you are creating a report builder report, you're actually creating a Excel document. And each one of those boxes represents a new column in your Excel sheet. And so oftentimes when you run these reports and you open up that Excel document, you see so many fields that it's kind of the old adage, you can't see the forest through the trees. And so when people run the report, they're like, oh my gosh, this isn't what I wanted at all. So my one tip to you is this. I always say less is more. And I always say, think to yourself, what do I absolutely have to have? Do I really just want to know the date that it was acquired and what the purchase price was or who the vendor was, and depending on what type of report you need? Seriously, have a conversation with yourself about what data is really important, because the fewer columns you have in that Excel sheet, I think in the end you're going to be much, much happier with the result of what it is that you get and that you see. There is also, in the handout section, I put two documents there. One document is called Creating a Report Builder Report. So if you would like to see that particular handout, again, go to handouts and you can download that report builder report. And the last thing that I'm going to end with talks about a very common question that I get a lot has to deal with when they're printing barcodes or spine labels. They line up at the top of the page, but by the time they get to the bottom of the page, they have shifted and they're off. So my recommendation to you is twofold. The first thing is definitely check out the two documents that I have in handouts. One is called Aligned Barcode Labels, and one is called Aligned Spine Label and Pocket Labels, because it will help you with those printer offsets that you're asked about, and that allows you to move your print left or right, top and bottom. So for me, when I printed spine labels, I liked my spine labels to be in the very center, left to right, and the very center from the top to bottom. A lot of people are just happy when they line up, and that's okay too. But if you've struggled any with getting your spine labels and barcodes to line up, definitely check out those two documents. I think they're going to be of help to you. And also, when you go to print your document, always within your printer settings, make sure that you uncheck the box that says fit to page. Because what you're doing by checking that box fit to page, your computer is automatically basically readjusting it so that it fits the nicest on that particular page. Well, if we're dealing about a sheet of paper, that's perfectly fine. But if we're dealing with labels that are stuck to a piece of paper, we can't have any shifting or changing occurring. So if you'll just uncheck that fit to page box, most of the time that resolves that problem. The other issue tends to resolve when you check out those printer offset documents that are listed there. So definitely check out the handouts because I think they're going to be really beneficial to a lot of people. The last thing that I'll do, let me close this out, is I want to show you when we're talking about Report Builder, please know those of you that work at a district level, when you log in as district library manager, whatever district username and password you have, when you get to the screen where you have the ability to save the report that you've created, you can create those reports where you can make them available to everyone in your district, just elementaries, high schools, middle schools, so forth and so on. And you have that ability to be able to share that document with them. But you also have the ability to run that report as well at the district level. And so if you are a district level administrator and you're looking for some time saving steps, just know that there are some of those reports that you can create and run at the district level that will allow you to compare all of your campuses simultaneously instead of having to go in and create that report and run it on each of your individual campuses. So definitely I wanted to make sure that I shared that with each of you. A couple of quick reminders. Anytime you are in Destiny and you're on the Reports tab, please don't forget that you can always click where it says Say More. Also, every time you're on a report option and you open it up, always in the upper right-hand corner of the page, there's always an item that will say How Do I? It's going to give you much more detailed information about that report. Don't forget that you can always go to Destiny's Help Center by clicking Help in that upper right-hand corner of every single screen that you have when you are in Destiny. Also, don't forget about going to the Fallout Community, which is where each of you signed up to be a part of today's webinar. And so this is where you have the ability to see archived webinars and, of course, register for other webinars throughout the year. All of our webinars for the entire year are posted in the Fallout Community, and we start welcome you and encourage you to sign up for those webinars. And of course, last but not least, always know that you can reach out to our friendly, helpful customer service staff. And so I've listed that number there, and I've also included what the options you press. So you start by pressing number 2, then you press option 2 again, and then lastly, you'll press option 1 for library manager. And so they are always a great team to reach out to and can get you that information. So, LaDonna, any questions before we stop recording?
I think that we are answering the last of the ones that have come through. We did a great job. We had a lot of people asking about the recording, and you will get a link for the recording with a follow-up email, and it will also be available on Community. So, awesome job, Camille.
Thanks so much. I know it's a lot of content today, and this is always a really popular webinar. And, of course, we can't cover it all in an hour, but we definitely tried to make sure we touched on the things that we commonly see as common questions. And so hopefully some of these were questions that you too have and feel a little more confident about that information. So what we're going to do is I'm going to stop the recording. When we end the webinar, or you close out your browser and you leave the webinar, survey will automatically load. We encourage you to please take a couple of seconds to answer that survey. It's very, very quick. I think there's only like 3 questions. And we also always ask the question, is there a topic that you would be interested in learning more about? And so we encourage you to definitely answer that question as well, because we would like to know what it is that you're interested in learning more about. So I'd definitely take the time to fill that out. But otherwise, I think we'll guys tell me when you want to end it.
Well, I was just going to, I've had a couple of people asking about all the different call number ranges under collection statistics. And so, just so people know, once you have used a call number, it's part of your history, and so it's going to be there. And so, if you have a lot of different ranges in there, it's because at some point, those different call numbers were part of your collection.
Gotcha. Yeah. And you can clean those up. I think I see... Mary, you asked that question, and you can clean it up by going to catalog and update copies, and then if you choose the option that says global update, it will automatically default to call number, and if you put that weird call number that you see in that list, if you put that call number in that top box, and then the second box for call number blank, and just hit update, it will automatically process that and remove that particular erroneous call number from that list when you're looking at that collection statistic summary. So definitely, I know when I look at my list, I have a ton of call numbers that I'm like, what in the world do these mean? But it's because previous librarians at the time thought it was going to be a great, you know, solution to an issue that they had at the time. But, you know, 10 years later, it doesn't mean anything to us. So we certainly have that opportunity to clean that up if you want.
And Mary, you also asked about genrefication. If you have sublocations in there but you don't have copy categories, your first step would be to create the copy categories that you need to match the sublocations. And then probably you would want to create a resource list where you added items into a sublocation. And it's a kind of a, it's a multi-step process, so it's more than what we can go through here, but you can definitely get those copy categories added there as part of a batch process. But I would recommend that you call tech support with that, because there's several steps that are involved.
Looks like we don't have any unanswered questions. Thank you so much, Linda and Gladys and Sherry and LaDonna.
All right.
No idea how awesome it is. Thanks so much, ladies. Have a great day.
Bye.